Harper Via and Harper Audio present Walking Practice, a novel by Dolki Min, translated by Victoria Cottle, performed by Nicky Endres. Kilometers. I'm off to work early. This isn't a regular occurrence. It's out of necessity today, because he says his house is only empty in the morning. He has too many choice qualities for me to let him slip through my fingers. And by qualities, I of course mean physical ones. I don't know what kind of human he is, what he likes to eat, his favorite color, the kind of music he's into these days. None of these interest me. We've simply exchanged a few words in a chat room and made a date. A fairly good-looking 27-year-old male, height 173 centimeters, weight 65 kilograms, and an 8-inch cock. That's all I know. Oh, and one more thing. He lives at the top of a 16-story apartment building. Right now, I'm heading there on the subway. You have no idea how relieved I am to be here, sitting pretty. So overjoyed I could burst into tears. No matter how you couch it, riding the subway feels disgusting. You dangle like ripe fruit from a hanging vine, squeezed in among humans swarming like bees. Especially on a day like this, when I'm not in top form, it gets harder to find my center of gravity on only two legs. That being said, the subway is so much better than the bus. It's a miracle if I don't fall over in those rattling steel-barred cells they call buses. It must have been 2 or 3 years after I settled down here. I didn't really have anything to do, nor any place in particular I needed to be. So I prowled the streets until, exhausted with nothing to show for it, I dragged my body to a bus stop. No. I must have brought myself there unconsciously. I didn't plan to take the bus home. But in those days, I was unaware that the subway stopped running at a certain time. I had seen people hail taxis a few times, but the prospect of trying it myself overwhelmed me with fear. Back then, just raising a hand up so that a driver could see it was an onerous task. I wouldn't have been able to endure the scrutiny of someone looking directly at the shape of my hand. Just imagining it made my hair stand on end. If I am to be completely honest, it keeps me from catching taxis to this day. Once, I plucked up the courage and stuck my hand out to hail one, and a toe popped out on my elbow. The taxi driver, eyes nearly popping out of his head, yanked the wheel and sped away. From then on, I've always kept my distance from taxis. But there are steep stairs on buses. There are no step buses now, but they've only just been introduced to the fleet. The first time I took public transportation, the height of the stairs was much greater than I expected, and I worried if I would even be able to climb them. All the stairs I had practiced on until then had been of negligible height and width. I grappled with gravity and climbed aboard the bus, claiming a small victory. The ascent was so laborious that I felt my bones might crumble, but the sense of accomplishment pleased me greatly. I thought the only thing left was to deposit my fare and find a seat. But before I could even catch my breath, the bus driver stomped on the accelerator and I tumbled to the back and got wedged under the bench. I was coated in dirt and sweat and droplets of blood. shocked. I couldn't move a muscle. Nor did I have the leisure to feel shame. The driver swore like nothing I'd heard before, and the other passengers jeered. They didn't even try to help. It never crossed their minds to reach out a hand, grab me by the tentacle, and pull me up. I was in far too disgusting of a state to arouse sympathy and a willingness to help. The high degree of concentration required to maintain my human-like form was in tatters. My eyeballs drifted in opposite directions, my arms and legs contorted, and my abdomen swelled up like a balloon. They must have been thinking, if only you were just a little less repulsive, I would step forward and lend a hand. I don't remember how I managed to get home after that. It was as if someone had extracted the splinters of memory from inside my head, like you would pluck a thorn from your skin. When I opened my eyes, I was sprawled out on the floor of my inky black living room. My shoes and clothes had burst apart like the carcass of a cat crushed beneath the tire of a car, unable to withstand my form. Painfully hungry, I could have killed on the spot. I am hungry now. In fact, I only brave the humidity and the piss stink of this environment because it is all worth it to get to him. Squeezing tight, I hug the bulky backpack balanced on my thighs. Inside it, all of my bright and shiny tools are sweetly tucked away in perfect order. They will help me satisfy my hunger. Whenever the subway rumbles, I keep my ear trained on the clinking and clanking sounds coming from inside my bag. I forget my hunger for the moment and fully relax. Drowsiness wells up within me, like it does when you sit in stillness and listen to the drip, drip, dropping of rain falling outside your window. The stress brought on by the train car being packed with passengers slowly fades away, and I drift into a shallow sleep. I wake up when my bag falls onto the floor with a dull kong. People turn their heads, eyes darting about, searching for the source of the noise. And once they see it is no big deal, they once again focus on their own business. While I wrestle the bag back into position on the tops of my thighs, a variable I hadn't considered comes to mind. You. You, dear reader, must be curious about my gender. Perhaps you are even feeling a little anxious. Or you might have scraped together clues from what I've said and how I've said it, constructing my gender to your own design. Regardless as to whether you are right or wrong, you will have come to your own conclusions. After I was thrown to this place against my wishes, I did my best to survive. I discovered that there are many of you who, when meeting someone new, first take their gender into account. I also get the impression that it is only after a gender has been assigned that you are seen as human. This process is completed so naturally and with such alacrity that you aren't even aware of automatically assigning gender to others. But there is a time when you do become aware, when you are uncertain of another's gender. You grow anxious when, wherever you may be, you encounter someone who you cannot immediately classify as male or female. Or, to put it another way, when the evidence for your gender judgment is conflicted. This is because, according to your narrow system of understanding, it is difficult to decide how to interact. For example, what honorific should you use with someone whose body you simply cannot decipher? You, dear reader, are an old hand at the gender-matching game. No doubt about it. From a tender age, you have guessed the gender of countless humans whose bodies are covered by clothes, coming to conclusions based on the gender you believe corresponds to the shape of genitals you believe match up with the remaining exposed parts of their bodies. And you have lived your lives in certainty, believing the result of your deductions to be true. The problem is, however, that you do not acknowledge the mistakes you have made and will continue to make. No one knows that the game itself is a mistake. Oh, I do apologize. I have yet to reveal my gender, leaving you, my dear reader, trembling with anxiety. How cruel. Well then, I will alleviate your anxiety. I'll now give you succor. Shall I put you at ease? Shall I ease your mind? I will relieve you. I am female. That is, at least I am until I have completed my journey to that man's house and taken care of my work. What does it mean to be a woman? Among other things, it means that you have to decorate yourself and act like a woman. No one has ordered me to do so. I willingly take on the responsibility. For if the performance is not carried out properly, I am nothing more than a monstrosity. It is imperative that I am not seen as a monster. My work and my life depend on it. Are you listening? Pay close attention to what I have to say. This is purely a matter of survival. If I don't become a woman, or when the occasion calls for it, a man, I will starve to death. If I mean to satisfy my hunger, then scarcely living will not suffice. We must always do more. Whether it is keeping 2 feet balanced on the bus or subway, or becoming a woman. Ah, now, it's almost time to get off the train. There are so many people on the subway. Sometimes it feels excruciatingly crowded. All of these people who poke their heads out and start swarming as soon as the sun rises, where do they hide themselves away at night? If for just one day they put an end to their ceaselessly stepping feet and constantly wagging tongues, I bet they'd all seize up in shock. I'm worried that not enough people will get off the train at the next stop. The mere thought paralyzes me. Even more so when I'm sitting far away from the automatic doors. I lack the confidence to bore through the mass of tightly packed people standing close as trees in a rarely traveled forest. And I can't bear the thought of having to spit out, "Excuse me, please, I'm getting off." Whenever startled or nervous, my voice cracks like a crowing rooster. It becomes something utterly unhuman. Even if I focus on vibrating my vocal cords and shaping my lips to produce an approximately human voice, if people ignore me or don't get out of my way, I'll be hopelessly trapped. And then I won't be able to meet him in time, and even if he kindly overlooks my lateness, it will still fuck up the timing of my next appointment. My plans for the whole day could be a bust. Oh, I am so frightened now. I do apologize. There's no reason for you to sit here listening to me fret. But I would be ever so pleased if you stick it out till the very end. I am a being wholly unrelated to you. But I am not living on some frozen planet 6 million light years away. I am right beside you. The screen doors slide open. The passengers are hurriedly fucking off like blood that finally penetrated an artery that's been blocked for 10 years. Who knows? I could even ardently love one of them, I quickly pack away my useless delusions and, feeling a bit dizzy, pass through the open doors. Once, about 9 years ago, I had my side rudely chomped down on by the subway doors. The doors have never apologized, and I still have not forgiven them. That's why I am chronically lightheaded and will continue to be so. But it doesn't matter. As long as
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.